Thank you, praise team, for bringing us to the foot of the cross this morning. Some of you have heard this before, but some of you may not have. The call on these people's lives that you see up here every Sunday, and every Wednesday night, they show up here at 6:30, and they're here till 8:30. And then they show up at 8:30 on Sunday morning, and they put in 3 or 4 hours of practice to lead in worship for 20 or 25 minutes on Sunday morning. And then, most of you know, we had a piano player that was with us for about 25 years or more. But when we lost that person, that put an extra call on the lives of two other people, our keyboard player and our bass player, that aside from the practice time, they put in several more hours composing the music that you hear each Sunday morning and that are the people who lead us in the words. And what has to be done on that is if you hear 8 or 10 musical instruments, those are all programmed in one instrument at a time through some special software in a keyboard that Mr. Trevino has, but he has to go in there and put those parts in for every song, and it takes hours. And thank God they've got that call on their lives, and God has fixed it where they enjoy doing it. So thank you, praise team, for that. This morning, the pastor asked me to step in for him. I hope he knows what he was doing when he did that. I'm reminded one of the first times I got up to speak in public, I was kind of like that guy that said, I stood up to speak, but my mind sat back down. And if that happens today, some of you are going to get out real early for lunch. But as a standing joke around here is, if that doesn't happen, you might be really late for lunch. This one fellow that he got called to pastor this country church, and so he shows up for his first Sunday, and through a series of events, only one person showed up for the Sunday morning service. And so he went out to the farmer and he says, look, you're the only one here. Do you really want to go through this whole service and a message? And the old farmer says, well, you know, when it's time to feed the cattle, and I pull the tractor and the trailer into the barn and load it up with hay, take it out to the field and only one cow shows up, I still feed it. So the new preacher says, okay. So they go through the whole service, and about 2 hours later, it ends, and he goes up to the farmer and shakes his hand, and he said, well, what did you think? He said, well, preacher, says, when it's time to feed the cows and I pull the tractor and the trailer into the barn and I load it up with hay and I take it out to the field and only one cow shows up, I don't give them the whole load. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, may you open the ears and hearts of us this morning as we share your word. I pray, Lord, that that which is spoken here this morning comes from you, Lord, and not me. If it comes from me, we're going to waste about 30 minutes. So I pray, Lord, that your anointing be upon this message and that it be within your will. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning, we celebrate in the Christian world Palm Sunday, Christ's victorious, triumphant entry into Jerusalem. A day that began a week that the people who celebrated on that day on such a high had no idea what was really fixing to happen. Today, I want to examine some incidents and some lessons we can learn from that week. The title of today's sermon is Nine Words, the hardest words for us as believers to say and do. I want to provide two examples from the scriptures, one on an individual believer and one on a crowd, that display an all too common human condition, and then our Savior's example in dealing with it. The first example is we'll look at Peter. Now, some of these things that we're going to talk about with Peter, most of you are pretty familiar with. The first scripture is out of Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 17. And it goes like this. When Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" So they said, "Some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Then in John 18, verses 4 through 11, we find this incident. Jesus, therefore, knowing of the things that would come upon him, went forward and said to them, "Who are you seeking?" He's in the garden, and these soldiers appear in that garden to arrest him. So these soldiers answered him and said, "We're looking for Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said to them, "I am he." And Judas, who betrayed him, also stood with them. Now when he had said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Then he asked them again, "Whom are you seeking?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I have told you that I am he. Therefore, if you seek me, let these go on their way, that the saying might be fulfilled which he spoke, 'Of those whom you gave me, I have lost none.'" Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. Now we see in these two instances, Peter in the presence of Christ, bold, brave, confident. "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Now there's a bunch of soldiers there in the garden, and he pulls out his sword and cuts off the servant's ear. But now, Let's look at Luke chapter 22, verses 55 through 62. Now when they had kindled a fire in the midst of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. And a certain servant girl, seeing him as he sat by the fire, looked intently at him and said, "This man was also with him." But he denied him, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." And after a little while, another saw him and said, "You're one of them." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." Then after about an hour had passed, another confidently affirmed, saying, "Surely this fellow also was with him, for he is a Galilean." But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you're saying." Immediately, while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed. And the Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times." So Peter went out and wept bitterly. What happened between "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God," facing soldiers with spears and swords and outnumbered, pulling your sword and cutting off a person's ear, and what happens in Luke 55 through 62, where he's faced with some people standing around the fire, one of them a servant girl, and he vehemently denies that he even knows Christ. Now let's look at what happens with the crowd. Let's look at John chapter 19, verses 29 through 38. And it came to pass, when he drew near to Bethphage and Bethany, at the mountain called Olivet, he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village opposite you, where as you enter you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Loose it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you, 'Why are you loosing it?' thus you shall say to him, 'Because the Lord has need of it.' So those who were sent went their way and found it just as he had said to them. But as they were loosing the colt, the owners of it said to them, 'Why are you loosing the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord has need of him.' Then they brought him to Jesus. They threw their own clothes on the colt, and they sat Jesus on him. And as he went, many spread their clothes on the road. Then, as he was now drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory to the highest.'" Then we go to Luke chapter 23, verses 13 through 21. Then Pilate, when he had called together the chief priests and the rulers and the people, said to them, "You have brought this man to me as one who misleads the people. And indeed, having examined him in your presence, I found no fault in this man concerning those things of which you accuse him. Nor neither did Herod, for I sent you back to him, and indeed nothing deserving of death has been done by him." I will therefore chastise him and release him. For it was necessary for him to release one to them at this feast. And they all cried out at once, saying, Away with this man, and release to us Barabbas, who had been thrown into prison for a certain rebellion made in the city and for murder. Pilate, therefore, wishing to release Jesus, again called out to them. But they shouted, saying, Crucify him! Crucify him! What happened? To the people from Palm Sunday, when there was shouting and celebration, glory to God in the highest. In Luke chapter 23, and sometimes we may not understand this, the word says that Pilate wanted to release Jesus, was looking for a way to release him. And the crowd yells out, Barabbas, Barabbas, and then what shall I do with him? Crucify him. What happened in there? Then we go to John 11, 41 through 48. The word says this. This is when Jesus is going to raise Lazarus from the dead. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was lying, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me, and I know that you always hear me, but because of the people who are standing by, I said this, that they may believe that you sent me. Now when he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he who had died came out bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, Loose him and let him go. Then many of the Jews who had come to Mary and had seen these things Jesus did believed in him. Now this is the religious leaders in this next section. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered a council and said, What shall we do? For this man works many signs. If we let him alone like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and the nation. What happened? People have just seen Jesus raise someone from the dead who had been dead for several days. And there was rejoicing. Religious leaders who should have known the word. People had been praying for hundreds of years for a Savior. And notice too what these religious leaders said. If we let him alone like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. And notice what order they put that in. They were afraid of losing their place, and oh, by the way, maybe the nation too. What happened here? Sometimes when we study the word, we find ourselves being very critical of how people acted back in this day and time. But we need to ask ourselves, would we have reacted just as these did? And when I ask myself that question, and I love studying history, I have to face a real tough answer to that question. Would I have reacted just as these did? Yep. Peter walked with Jesus in his public ministry for years and months. And look at what happened to him. He saw Jesus Christ alive and in person, and looked at what happened to him. I have not seen Jesus in the physical body, alive and in person, and followed him day by day for several years, and seen with my own eyes what he taught, what he did. Do we respond in these same ways even today with the hindsight we have? When we look at the world, when we look even at ourselves as believers in the church and in the country, in the world to live in, I fear that the answer to that question is yes, even though we know more than they did back in those days because we have the word, we still find ourselves reacting in the same way. I still find myself far from where I need to be. The same things that plagued those people in those days still plague us as individuals and as corporate believers. Life cares, distractions and circumstances, selfishness, fleshly and worldly ambitions, fears, loss of prestige, inadequacy, a loss of the power that we think we have, a lack of knowledge, a lack of faith. But what example did Jesus provide that we should follow to fulfill God's will in our lives? And we can find that in Matthew chapter 13, verses 32 through 36. Then they came to a place which was named Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And he took Peter, James, and John with him, and he began to be deeply troubled and deeply distressed. I wished I could, or was a scholar in Greek, because I'm sure that the Greek that this was originally written in would have a more explicit way of talking about where Jesus was at this point. But it says here, he was troubled and deeply distressed. The Son of the living God, part of the Godhead, taking on flesh and being a man, deeply troubled, deeply distressed. He said to them, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch." He went a little further and fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will." Those 9 words, "Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will." Jesus knew what he was fixing to go through. Now, in his human body and in his mind and his spirit, he knew what he was fixing to go through. But in his humanness, he could not even imagine the pain and anguish, the physical pain and anguish that he was fixing to go through. And that was pretty horrible. But over and above that, when you read some of the other scriptures, was the fact that in taking on our sin, he was going to be cut off from the Father for that brief moment. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. The hardest words for us to say and live by. And that's why we need Jesus. Because living by that is what we're to aspire to. To have that relationship that we want to fully fulfill in our lives and have the relationship in our lives that the Father provides for us through Jesus. Now, how does that apply to us here at First Baptist Church today? What are you and I being asked to sacrifice? Paul puts it this way in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Not unreasonable, reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. How do we get there? How do we get to this place? When you look at the news, you can see that the sacrifice that believers have to make in other parts of this world, imprisonment, beating, beheading, torture, all kinds of terrible things. God has blessed us to live in this country. What is he asking us to sacrifice? He's asking us, perhaps, to sacrifice a beautiful trip to the lake for a fishing trip on Sunday mornings. He's asking us maybe to get up an hour and a half earlier, participate in fellowship in Bible study with fellow believers, and then come together for a worship time. He's asking us, not necessarily because of the beautiful place that we live in this day and time, there are things that we can do that are not necessarily sin, that give pleasure in our lives, but are we supposed to be doing that versus something better? You can look in our bulletin, it's been there for several weeks now, some of the needs and positions that need to be filled at this church. There are children that need to know about Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior out in this community and in this church. Is God calling you to walk away from things that are not necessarily sinful, but asking you to find yourself in a position where you can minister to children? We're fixing to lose a person that's been working with our youth. Is God calling you to a position of working with our youth? Our new pastor, in conversations that the search committees had with him, some of us as individuals, I believe that this man has been called here by God, and he, in the next few weeks, as he gets to know us better, is going to be issuing a challenge to those of us who come into this place as believers to step out of our comfort zone and reach the people of Del Rio, Texas, for Jesus Christ. And some of what he's going to ask us to do, we're going to be uncomfortable with. We're going to have to make a decision. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. We need to get inside ourselves that some of the people you're friends with, some of the people you work with, some of the children you see, some of the teenagers you see, if they do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, they're walking around in the flesh with breath in their body, but they are dead. They're dead. We need to understand the urgency of that. People we may even enjoy hanging out with, and they don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, they're dead. And God has blessed us in two very important ways. Look at this complex that he has provided for us as a toolbox to work out of. There's a lot of places in the world they don't have anything like this. And the second thing he has blessed us with is, in spite of our shortcomings and stuff like that, he has given us the privilege and the command to use our talents and our gifts to work in partnership with him in spreading the good news of the gospel. Both with our mouth, our example, and our loyalty to the gospel and to each other. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. As individuals, and as a church, God is in this place this morning. The altars are open. Worship team, Dunamis Spirit, will you come? Deacons, those of you who are down here on the bottom floor, if you are so inclined, if you would come to the front and sit up here. The altars are open. Deacons are available for us to deal with these words this morning. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. Lord, what we remember this week and what we will be celebrating within this week. Is the most awesome thing in the history of your creation. Paul said that if Christ not be raised from the dead, everything that we do as believers, everything that we think as believers, is useless and in vain. But next week, we're going to celebrate our Lord and Savior conquering death, conquering the flesh, conquering the world, and being risen from the dead. So as the Lord leads you this morning, whether in your place or whether you feel to come up here and pray at the altars, or you would like to pray with one of our deacons or myself, deal with this morning. If we can figure out how to deal with, but His will be done, everything else in the scriptures and stuff will be of a mighty benefit to us. In Jesus' name, I pray.